Watch who?
Hello.
Hello, and welcome to Two Watch Who, a Doctor Who podcast. I'm Mark.
I'm Sarah.
And I'm a Doctor Who fan.
And I'm new to watching Coombe.
Watching for the very first time.
Very first time.
And you join us, everybody. We are in the wilderness years of the 90s. I don't know what to say. Just like the weird straight-to-video spin-offs. We're in our weird, like, in-between classic and new phase at the moment. So welcome, everybody, to that.
To that. Welcome to that.
And we started last time. We did Dimension in Time last week, which was a little appetizer of what the 90s could offer up in terms of Doctor Who, or Doctor Who not being on the television.
It was short, simple, sweet, wasn't it?
Yes. So really, I feel like today is like the proper start of the 90s things that we're going to be doing. I don't really have anything to sort of update, really. I mean, it's sort of...
Well, I think we should be honest with people. We are more ahead than what is out in the world right now.
So. Well, it's sort of, I don't know, it's sort of getting sort of autumn-y. It got autumn-y very suddenly, I feel.
One of my jobs tonight, me and Mark, I'm just going to set the scene for everyone, okay? Me and Mark are recording. It's a Saturday night. That we never record on a Saturday night. It is a Saturday night. We are both free, and so we're recording on a Saturday night. I am not working. This never happens. Never happens. I'm sat here with my cat. I'm talking with Mark. I'm thinking Indian tonight, Indian takeaway.
Nice.
And one of the jobs on my to-do list is to swap the summer clothes out to make space for the winter jumpers to go in. I've already got the winter jumpers out because you're right, it did suddenly go very cold. They're just on the floor at the minute. It's not a good situation.
And, well, I'm sorry you've had to watch Probe, the Zero Imperative.
Well, you said that, but actually, it wasn't as bad as I expected.
No, do you know what? It's not too bad. And I do want to go through the story at some point because some of our listeners, I'm sure, haven't seen this, so I do want to set the scene a bit more than maybe we usually would, just to explain what is going on. Okay, first off, so this is, we're in 1994 still, and this is straight to video, sort of set, I would describe it as semi-professionally made. I mean, there's no budget here, but I don't really want to get caught up on like no production, no budget. It looks like it's not be, you know, it's like a training video. It's that kind of vibe, you know? Like halfway through, that woman from the Pringles Co-op training video could have turned up. It's not been like filmerized or anything like that. Not home video camera, but just sort of a few up from that. It did end up in like Woolworths a few years later on and stuff. So it did sort of get out there a bit, but it's very, very cheap. But I think we should focus on the story and the characters more because these are all...
Well, you say that, but I don't think it's as cheap as you're giving it credit.
No, I suppose not.
Actually, it's not because the acting's really good and we'll go into it more. But I was watching it and I was like, do you know what? Seeing them because they're not playing their characters, they are actors at this point in roles, right? So you get to appreciate them as actors. And I was like, they're great actors.
Oh, they all are. Yes, they are.
You know, even our companions who are in it and everyone like, the cast is strong. They're in it because of the gimmick of them having been in Doctor Who, but everyone in it is a strong actor. And that was quite a nice thing to watch and to see them in something different, I guess, in a different way. So you say like, Pringles lady from Co-op, but actually other than, and even some of the effects and the way it was done, it wasn't awful. There was maybe one or two moments, like you say. It was more, I'd say, student film. Like if a student was making a film, but you were having professional actors.
Yes. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
That's how I would do it. That's how I would probably
word it. It's not like broadcastable on a main channel sort of thing.
Yeah. What you have on screen is good. But like maybe some of the choices, angles, there's a few little things like that maybe aren't as strong.
There's obviously no money for it. It is made for the fans still. It's not really made for anybody else anyway, which is why all these Doctor Who actors are in it at the end of the day, you know. And it's not like we can do like clothes watch or anything, because I think it's literally like the actor's own clothes and stuff like that. Do you know what I mean? There's like zero budget. But no, I do really like this. I didn't watch this at the time or anything. I don't know how old was I in 94? Not that old. So I wouldn't have watched this. So I've only got it on DVD the last couple of years, this particular one. I think they are being appreciated again now. I mean, there's this whole, you know, they've gone down in fan sort of history, you know, all these spin-offs and stuff. But it was what was keeping things going, you know. There was no Doctor Who on TV. It was, by this point, they're all still talking about there's going to be a film, blah, blah, blah. Nothing's happening.
I think what's interesting about this, watching it, it does not feel like Doctor Who in any way, right? Even, I mean, other than it being Liz Shaw, but like you said, it has nothing to do with anything that Liz Shaw did before or anything. It feels so far removed from any of that. What is, I think, just nice about it, like I said, was just seeing those people that you've seen on your TV for years and getting to see them in something. So I think in terms of the Whoniverse, it's just keeping it alive. It's like, oh, these were all these people that were in this show, like throughout different years, that weren't even on it at the same time as each other.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's sort of like a fan convention, isn't it? You know, where they all get together and do, you know, something like that.
Like the Five Doctors or something.
Yeah, it's something like that. But actually, in terms of like the story and the tone of it, because Doctor Who's not on TV, and we've mentioned before the books are out, you know, the books with, you know, Dodo getting her STD and all that kind of stuff. This is this is very 90s. This is where fans were taking Doctor Who. It's of its time as well, because you've got like the X-Files and stuff coming up. You've got, you know, on TV in general, in fiction and everything, it is this kind of sort of darker sort of tone, which was happening in the Doctor Who books. So naturally, it's going to sort of happen in this as well. We're not going to get like a light-hearted thing. It's always going to be, you know, a bit more serious, a bit more sort of blood and gore, and trying to be sort of legitimate in that, you know, we've just come out of the, you know, Sylvester McCoy and everything, where a lot of fans were like, it's silly and over the top and pantomime and everything. And I think it's sort of the fans trying to take it back again now and be like, this is how we want Doctor Who to be. If not that that's like the right way for it to be necessarily, but you know, they're wanting this uncool show to be cool. And you know, this is made a lot by fans. I mean, this is written by Mark Gatiss and he's in it as well, and this is like his early acting and writing stuff before he became, you know, he's ended up in the new series and wrote for the new series and stuff. This is where all the sort of people that are involved in the new series now started, you know, started their writing and directing and acting, you know.
It's interesting because I think of him as League of Gentlemen or Inside Number 9 and stuff like that. And I didn't know that he was a massive Doctor Who fan. So I looked it up afterwards, after I'd watched it, and like literally on his wiki, there is a whole part that is just Doctor Who. That's crazy. It's interesting if you think about it, how many writers out there, and that says a lot about the show, how many writers out there were influenced by Doctor Who? We're talking 80s now, 70s and 80s, that are now like in different media, you know, we're not just drama, but like in comedy and stuff like that. And Sherlock, like he was in Sherlock, wasn't it? Like, it's just interesting, isn't it? But he was a big fan.
They all were. All the people involved. Like in this time, in the 90s, Russell T. Davis wrote one of the books as well.
Absolutely.
Like, it's all of that. So this, you can see that, and you will see that throughout these videos as well. So even if, you know, at the end of the day, that is their achievement, that is their history, to bring these people. I'm making it sound like it's a massive thing. At the end of the day, it's a straight to video thing. We should get on with it, right?
No, but it's an interesting thing because I think, well, I don't know. I mean, I'll get deep on it here, but like we talk about, I look now at like the arts and like, I mean, we've both worked in the industry and you're still working in it. I've just come out for a bit and like funding and like we talk about like how do people come into these industries and like, where are influences of this and all this sort of stuff and opportunities for stuff like that? at this point in time in the 90s, this thing isn't on TV, right? And yet it, for so many different people, this is still a huge influence. I will also bring back, which I still, someone will have this somewhere, but I just think it's interesting for gay men in particular. I just wonder what it was particularly about the show that they also were connecting to. I don't know. I just find that interesting.
I think there's many a book and a thesis out there on that.
I'm sure there is. It's just there's a lot of different interesting levels and layers that these people who have gone on to become famous writers and stuff like that, and who have been influenced of that period that we've just finished. We're now in the 90s where they are in their 20s and, you know, 20s and writing and doing these things and being creative and entering industries and stuff. It's just interesting. I'm sure there's many a thesis on the matter.
There is. I mean, so this is made by, this is like it's called BBV. So Bill Baggs is the guy that has put this together and directing this and making this. And he was a fan in the 80s, and he was with a lot of these creative people making fan audios, you know, just like for other fans and stuff. And then he's got the idea of, okay, let's try and make something here. I think his ambition was always to make a TV series or something like that, but you know, it never happened. So it was more just straight for the fans. And he's obviously got rights to use the character of Liz Shaw, which is great. I mean, we love Liz Shaw.
We love Liz Shaw. It's just such a weird non-Liz Shaw. Well, look, there's, from what I read, there's 4 episodes that were done.
God, you'd be reading. Hang on a second.
Mark has nothing to say. I did read after. I mean, we've only watched one, right? So I'm not sure whether the others touch more Lizzie, but like this one, it felt very un-Liz Shaw. And I don't know whether this one is particularly to have more of those actors in to get you ooh.
I mean, one, if you can only get the character of Liz Shaw, you've got to go with it. You've got to make it, again, just going back to the production stuff, you've got to make it sort of down to earth. I mean, I probably mistakenly said it's like a sort of silent witness style thing, but it's probably not exactly like that. But you've got to make it, you can't have it, you know, you can't have aliens, you can't have spaceships or anything like that necessarily if you haven't got the budget for that. So it's got to be down to earth, a bit like UNIT. So we've got PROBE instead of UNIT here, which is the Preternatural Research Bureau, PRB. I don't know where the O and the E have come from, but it makes PROBE instead of PRUB. I can see that, you know, where they've got that, you know, Liz, she went off to Cambridge after she left UNIT. She was always that scientist person making the vaccines for Silurians and everything. And she does mention here, there is a picture of the Brigadier on the wall, and she's, you know, she does say, oh, this is where I've been sent, kind of thing. It's not so far from Liz Shaw, I don't think. I mean, she's not doing the science. She's doing the more investigative. She's a bit more Sarah Jane in a way.
Well, yeah, it kind of is. I feel like maybe it needed like a 5-minute how she ended up on this. Not even 2-minute line of like how she ended up on PROBE.
Yeah, there's not really any. You're straight into it, aren't you? You're straight into what's going on.
And I'd like to sort of, how did you get into this? So how were you brought into this project? Like, oh, I was working on something at Cambridge and I was brought in. Something like that. Wouldn't even need to say, you could say something like, well, I was working on a vaccine and based on my, you know, that fans would understand maybe, but doesn't hint exactly.
Well, was she sort of mid-investigation here? So, okay, let's go back to the beginning. Let's just explain what's going on for people that maybe haven't seen this. So we're at a psychiatric facility. It all starts off a bit sort of scary, and there's something going on, and there's weird voices and all that kind of stuff. And we have Sylvester McCoy as the clinic director. He's called Dr. Dove. And he is holding a press conference. And you see Sophie Eldred as his assistant for like one scene.
Yes. For one scene and then never seen again.
She had other work that day. So he's saying, I don't know, the NHS has decided that all these facilities are shutting down, but we have been given like 1 year extra. We are going to stay open. We are not closing down. And Liz Shaw comes in as part of like the in the conference. So she's doing her invest. So you sort of do think she's a journalist in that sense, that she comes in with a notepad, you know, with everybody else.
She's a journalist.
She is. She's a new journalist. So that's going on. And the guy that has come in to sort of take over, the new trustee of the psychiatric hospital.
He's the one that's funded it.
Who's funding it, who is keeping it open, is Colin Baker. I'm just going to call them their actor names from now on. So Colin Baker's coming to take over Sylvester McCoy's psychiatric facility.
Well, I understood it as he hasn't come up to take over, he's funded it.
Well, yeah, but he wants to... Yeah, he's put the money in to keep it going. I mean, Sylvester McCoy's still in charge, but, like, Colin Baker's above him in terms of, like, financial things.
Yeah, because he's funded
I don't think anybody would ever guess that we're talking about the financial situations of the psychiatric hospital in Prove right now, but we are. Right.
If we get this graph here...
and then we see our... The doctors that work in the psych... So we've got Mark Gatiss and we've got... I'm going to say blonde woman and brunette woman. I'm so sorry. I'm just not going to... There's B, it's the blonde one. I didn't get the name of the other one, who's not in it much. It's really just Mark Gatiss and B.
And because I was trying to work out if the blonde one, because she's in it a lot, if she was anyone that I should have remembered. And I kept looking at her like... Oh, you're someone I should remember. And she's not, I don't
know. No, so that's the thing. I was thinking that as well. I was like, are you going to think these people used to be in Doctor Who and they're not? So we've got a weird mix of Doctor Who actors and other actors they brought in. So no, she has not done... I looked up...
She has a familiar face.
I always think she looks like, and she's not, the woman that was in Coupling, that sitcom. She looks a bit... There's like a comedy actress that looks like her, but it's not her.
She looks a bit like Sam Fox.
And Sam Fox, yes. Yeah. They all look the same. Those three do all look the same. I know who you mean, but it's not Sam Fox. They're working. They're talking about, oh, you know, what's, you know, they're doing their day-to-day stuff. And there is a emergency and somebody has been killed in one of the wards. So it's very gory. I mean, this is like, finally, I mean, well, I was going to say the Sixth Doctor, it would happen in the Sixth Doctor story, but they can go a bit more further with the blood and the gore in these things, can't they? That's all weird going on. And there is, as like a secure unit, and there is patient zero in the secure unit who is this, like, we keep seeing shots of this old man, like, looking, like, creepy.
And that is just an old man.
Yeah, he's not in Doctor Who. He's just an old man.
Again, I kept trying to work out if it was Patrick Troughton or something.
I mean, I'm sure if Patrick Troughton or William Hartnell was around, I'm sure they would totally love to be patient zero.
I literally peeping at the screen trying to work it out.
It could have been. I could have said he was in Keith Emeritus and you'd have been like, yeah, fine.
Exactly. I'd have bought it.
You would have bought this DVD straight away. Right, so there's something weird going on with Patient Zero. No one's allowed to see him. Weird stuff's going down, right? Then Liz comes back to her Probe office, which is just like the worst office ever. Just literally like completely empty room with like one computer and a desk. And she's got a little team with her. So she has got...
Layla.
Layla. Layla, her boss. Is basically
Layla. Layla is Layla. Yeah,
I wasn't sure if you'd recognise her actually, but she, I suppose you would. Louise Jameson is her boss from like the government or whatever.
Layla.
And then she's got, oh, what's her name? And then she's got another lady with her. And that's played by Linda Lusardi, who again could have been in Doctor Who, but she's not. That's her friend that she's chatting to and makes her coffees. He doesn't really do much in this, but it's sort of Liz's companion. They could have made a bit more of that and had that as Liz's companion in a way. But Linda Lusardi used to be a Page 3 girl in the 70s and 80s. And I was just looking up her career. I mean, this is one of the sort of earlier things she did in terms of acting. I don't know why they decided to get Linda Lusardi in this. It's this like random... It's like... The equivalent of today being like, we're doing a Sarah Jane Adventures and we're going to get Katie Price to be in. It's like that. But
maybe they were just like, we need people and she wanted to move into acting. And
that is basically it. Yeah. But she did The Bill a bit later on. She does like Llandudno pantomimes now and stuff. She is working in... But this is like one of her first acting jobs, I think. So, which she does pretty good. I quite like the character, actually. It's just a shame she didn't do very much. So Liz is saying to Louise Jameson and Linda Lusardi, there's something going on with the clinic. There's like seven deaths and they're all within the vicinity of this clinic. Something weird is going on. It's up to us. We are unit/probe. We need to find out what's going on. The weirdest thing in that scene is that Liz smokes a pipe. This is what she's famous for. Like, out of all the things.
Yeah.
I think maybe Caroline John was a smoker and that's her actual own pipe, possibly, and was like, oh, this is a character thing for me. I feel like a lot of these things, I mean, this is just speculation, but I feel like a lot of these things where you get these actors in, I mean, it's not like Caroline John is doing a lot of work necessarily at this time, you know, or a lot of these actors, and you get them in, and they sort of put a bit more, they've got a bit more control because they are the star of the thing. Star. It's all around them. And if you've got like a director or someone, you know, fan directors or people, I feel like the actors can probably be like, I'm going to smoke a pipe and I'm going to do this because that's what I want to do for my character. And you can't really say no to it.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm just guessing, maybe I've just made all that up, but it could have happened. You know,
it's such a random thing to be like, and now she's going to smoke a pipe.
Yeah. Yeah, but maybe, you know, is it supposed to be like Sherlock Holmes?
Maybe.
That kind of thing. But her acting, you're right, her acting is brilliant. Caroline John is absolutely wonderful. She always was as Liz, but she really holds it together. She's not actually, in terms of her investigating, she's not in it as much as I thought. I suppose it's not like the Liz Shaw adventures, but she is the main investigator. But a lot of it happens when she's not there.
Yeah.
Which I feel like in a Miss Marple or something, Miss Marple would be more involved in all of the characters, but she's not. She only visits the psychiatric thing like twice.
Yeah, yeah. She goes like that first time for the press conference. She goes back to say, you need my help. And then the third time she goes back,
yeah,
she's
so
in
a lot
it.
Of it sort of happens when she's not there. So she's like, I'm investigating this place. The guy, Colin Baker, who's taken it over, is nothing to do with the medical profession. Why is he suddenly interested? Works out. So John Pertwee is also in this, everybody, in like a little bungalow that's right next to the psychiatric hospital.
Just happens to be next to the site.
Like a porter cabin that's just on site. And I was like, I thought he was a patient, but he used to run it and then is like retired and decides to live on site, I guess.
Yeah, I feel like it was done in somebody's actual house.
I feel like that's actual John Pertwee's conservatory or something.
Yeah, I feel like it was actually done in someone's house, that scene. Because it looks quite nice. It looks like someone's actual home.
I would be absolutely happy to retire and live in that. No problems. It's nice. You got your sofa, you got your books, you got your record player.
Yeah.
Just chill out there. Lovely. And then Liz is doing her paperwork and realises that Colin Baker is... Well, not John Pertwee's son, but John Pertwee's his guardian, his legal guardian, because Colin Baker's family all died or something. Anyway, Colin Baker didn't have a family and John Pertwee adopted him. And so she's like, hang on a second, that's weird. Meanwhile, we have Sylvester McCoy and John Pertwee like chatting about stuff going on. They know what's happening, but they're not telling anyone else, right? Are we all following this so far? Great.
Yeah, because now you're going to throw in Turlough.
Mark Gatiss. Who's Turlough?
I thought Turlough was in it.
Turlough isn't in this. What are you talking about?
I thought it's Mark Gatiss Turlough. I thought Turlough was in it.
Turlough?
Do I mean Turlough?
Okay, I'm really confused what you're talking about. Mark Gatiss plays one of the characters, yeah?
Yeah, hang on.
Turlough?
You know who I mean.
Mark Strickson is Turlough.
Yeah.
He's not in this. That's Mark Gatiss.
I thought he was. So it must be Mark. Yeah, my bad.
I'm really confused. Mark Gatiss wrote this and is in this, yeah?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I thought he was a much more minor character. I thought Mark Gatiss was a minor character and I thought that character was Turlough.
Okay. Oh, my God.
I told you, I'm looking for people everywhere.
Okay, no, sorry. It's Mark Gatiss throughout the whole thing. Sorry, it's gone really dark here. Can you see me?
Yeah,
I'm just going to put the light on a second. Oh.
Mark is suddenly in the dark.
He does look... Okay. Oh, there we go. He does look a bit like Turlough, to be fair, but he's not. So it's Mark Gatiss throughout.
Okay,
so he is... working his job, and he's like, something weird's going on, sort of knows a bit. He's doing the history of the place, isn't he? He's looking up the history. And then he talks to B, the blonde girl, who's never been in Doctor Who, and she doesn't want to know. She's like, what are you talking about? There's supposed to be some weird love interest thing there, but it's not happening. And then, you know, and then John Pertwee's like, any action in the Y-front department? I'm like, I don't want John Pertwee saying lines like that. Please. You just don't want that, do you? Like, who wanted that?
Maybe John Pertwee.
Weird things are happening. Oh, yeah, I'm skipping all over the place a little bit now, but that blonde girl is sort of having some fling with Sylvester McCoy. And again, yeah. You do not want to see them snogging, but unfortunately you do. Like, she's got bright red lipstick on, and after that snog, all of her lipstick is gone. She's got it, like...
He goes for it. He goes for it.
He really does, doesn't he? So
I don't blame him, but he goes for it. He gets in there.
There's another death, I think, as well.
I can't remember. There's a lot of deaths.
Basically, what is going on? Colin Baker is like, I'll look through some of these files because I want to know what's going on. It's not really explained why he came back and took over this place, but he sort of felt drawn there. And anyway, cut a long story short, the weird patient guy in the room that is like, I don't know, causing like weird deaths or influencing people and giving people nightmares, and we've got creepy moments, blah, 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 is John Pertwee's brother.
Yeah.
And Colin Baker's dad, who's never been in Doctor
Who. I didn't get the brother bit, but I got the dad bit. Yeah.
So what happened basically was...
And he's told that, like, he's dead. And then he goes to the thing and he's like, there's my dad.
Yes. So all this is happening. Liz isn't really getting involved. She's having like a meeting with Sylvester McCoy and being like, there's weird stuff going on. You need to, you need to let me investigate with my team.
Yeah. And then she comes back and he's like all freaked out and like hiding in a cell or whatever.
So he's going a bit weird, and he basically explains there's a word. I can't remember the word. Meaning like there's a comet or something that's going to enter the Earth's atmosphere. It's like the nearest point to a sun or some weird explanation. And it's basically one sort of dimension meeting another of like evil that has happened on this thing. And he knows that that's happening. And it's like the countdown is coming. And that's what's been influencing all of these people on this site for however many years. And Patient Zero is like a conduit for that. That's why Colin Baker was drawn back, because he's the son and he's like psychic or whatever. It's all like psychic stuff. And then John Pertwee's brother was at the facility and like murdered all of his family because he got taken over by this evil thing like in the 50s or whatever. So that's why John Pertwee knows about it. Sylvester McCoy knows about it because, I don't know, he's in charge as well. Whoever's always been in charge. Yeah. And then Mark Gatiss gets killed, and then Liz comes in, and I don't know how it finishes, actually.
Well, what it finished with was Peter Davidson sat there.
Oh, well, okay, that's skipping right to the end. Basically,
that's how it finished, you asked me.
Sylvester McCoy gets killed, the patient guy gets killed. I think the only way to stop it is to kill that guy, Patient Zero.
Yeah, because he's about to kill Liz Shaw. And he goes, no, and he gets upset. Yeah.
So basically, Colin Baker survives, John Pertwee survives, Liz Shaw survives. Because that patient's died, that's all happened. But then right at the end, you see patient number one, and it opens the door, and it's Peter Davison, end of. So basically, we're looking at like psychic weird stuff that's going on. Not really alien-y, could be alien-y. It's never like, it's not really about that, is it? It's about the mystery and the characters. And I just loved watching Liz Shaw investigate, you know, going to the morgue, doing her silent witness thing there, you know, that kind of stuff. I would have appreciated more of that.
Yeah. I kind of get, though, why they didn't, especially for a first. If you wanted to do this, if your aim here was to get this as a TV series, I get why you wouldn't do that for a first episode, because you're trying to, like, you want to show all these people that you've got involved to get fans hooked. I get it.
So, yeah, I'm really surprised that you followed this all right.
Yeah, pretty much. Other than like the brother thing, I followed that and thinking it was Turlough, I followed it completely.
I think Colin Baker's really strong in this, watching it again.
Yeah, I think everyone's really strong in it. Everyone. There's no one I think's weak.
The only dodgy part, I think, is right at the beginning, and it's not great. He's doing the press conference. Sylvester McCoy's doing a press conference, and he's like, I'm here to talk to you today. And then Liz walks through, and he sort of does this very theatrical pause, as if like he knows there's going to be a pause. She walks in, and then he carries on his line. It's very
queued
up.
I think some of that might be also an edit.
True, yeah.
So like some of that might be like how it's been filmed, and then experience of like editing. Like if you had more experience of that, and directing as well, whoever's been directing it.
But no, I think it's a great start and it's a great idea. And I would love it if Liz Shaw had her own series like this, you know, doing all this kind of stuff.
To the point where I would almost watch, I feel like I would watch another episode.
Okay, so yeah, you would be interested in seeing, say this was a pilot episode for a series of Liz Shaw Investigates.
If you were to say to me the next thing you're watching is a second episode of this, I wouldn't be upset.
Okay, that's cool. I, do you know what? I think sometimes having all the actors in it, it depends if this makes it for you or not, having all of those other actors is a bit distracting. What if it was just Liz Shaw, Caroline John, and then everybody else was played by non-Doctor Who people?
I think if it was like one actor as a special thing, do you know what I mean? Like, so you knew that, like, so if you have Liz Shaw, like, you know, you've got that team who are maybe, and because they're not, you know, like your main team are like people. And then it's like you have one guest person who's in one episode. So you sort of know, like, oh, this week's special guest would be John Pertwee, and that's it. And the next ones would be Peter Davidson, and that's it. So you're not like trying, for me, for example, thinking like Turlough was in it for an entire episode, or like, yeah, just trying to like work out who people are all the time.
Yeah, maybe. But I suppose also the appeal of it for them to do it, I mean, they're not getting paid anything really to do this. They're just doing it for fun. They're probably doing it so they can just hang out with each other.
Yeah, exactly.
So you've got to get that balance, I suppose. And they might.
But if you were to make it a TV show where there would be budget and stuff.
Yes, yeah.
That would be different. Yeah, sometimes, I kind of get why at this point. They're just doing it because, you know, it's fun and you get to hang out with people, you know.
Because I love seeing, like, Liz Shaw, but then sometimes it's distracting when you're watching, like, Sylvester McCoy. You're just thinking, seeing him as the Doctor and seeing, like, similar things he did as the Doctor. It's really difficult.
But I didn't. I really didn't.
But I suppose because you're not, I mean, you've seen them, obviously, as a Doctor and stuff, but I've only really seen Sylvester McCoy do, you know, one or two other things. He's always the Doctor when you see him immediately. But if it's somebody else that's not necessarily used to them as much and just sees them as an actor.
Oh, but you say that. The only way I've seen these actors is on this. I haven't seen Sylvester McCoy in other things. But I didn't watch this. And like, I thought I would. But actually, like, I thought I'd think when it started, there was that initial like, oh, it's them. But actually, it went away quite quickly. Like, I just thought, oh, actually, they're really good actors. They're really, like, that I kind of appreciated them as actors rather than, oh, yeah, it's the Seventh Doctor doing this, ooh, whatever, you know.
And there's the really nice scene at the end where they're having the cake, tea and cake. And, but because they're all playing doctors.
Yeah.
Like psychiatric doctors. Yeah, you can refer to them as doctor. So John Pertwee pours the tea and Liz says, thank you, doctor. And there's a little moment. Yeah. You know, that's obviously written in for that. That's nice. It is great seeing John Pertwee, actually, because he's, I mean, we saw him last time in Dimensions in Time doing his thing. It's weird to actually see him do like a serious role, if you can call it that. Because when he's playing the doctor, I feel like he's playing John Pertwee being a bit of a, you know,
well, it's like a heightened character, isn't it?
But in this, he's really trying to play like a serious, like if he was in The Bill or something like that. I've never really seen him do that before. And I don't think he really got the opportunity to do anything like that. He was always playing over the top people. And he's really trying to play it. I feel like he did that because, you know, it was an opportunity to stretch his acting abilities a little bit. but it's weird seeing him in that role, and it's just weird seeing them all interact. That's part of the fun of it, isn't it? But no, I am glad you liked it. I mean, I've seen it a couple of times now, and every time I see it, I enjoy it more, I think, actually. It is out on DVD. I don't think it's anywhere legally on. I think you can buy the download as well.
Well, the thing is, we start getting back to the 2000s when suddenly the BBC wants to start doing stuff again, and they start paying people to be involved.
I mean, yeah, again, true. This is what's happening at the time. The BBC do not care about Doctor Who. They're not interested. They're like, yeah, fine, go and use Liz Shaw or whatever. We're not going to challenge you. You know, there's nothing here that they can say it's copyright of Doctor Who. They're very clever when they make all these things to just get around all of these legalities and stuff. But then, the BBC didn't care anyway, you know?
No, exactly.
So anyway, there we go. I feel like this is the proper start of the 90s. Oh, yeah, this was a question. Do we want to do a 90s Doskers at some point? Are we going to do a 90s Doskers?
I don't know. We'll have to see how it works.
We can either do sort of all of... I've got, basically, what you're looking
I don't
like.
Know how many... I don't know. I'm not...
Okay, we've got 13. I've got 13 90s things. So we could do half and half and do a Doskers in the middle, or do 13 and do a Doskers at the end. Let us know, people.
We have to do it. I don't know how long everything is. So it's up to you. Now, my instinct is to say at the end, we've done long series before, like series one, but you might be like, and now you've got to watch 5 episodes of this, and actually 13 is more like, so I'm not the one to ask. I haven't a clue what's coming up. So
no, let's do it at the end. Let's do it. Because it'll be interesting, I think, to do a Doskers, because we can have, you know, like Sylvester McCoy will be up as best villain in this because he was the baddie of the piece, you know, stuff like that.
Yeah, true.
You know, Liz Shaw could be hero. she's definitely got, you know, she pushed Colin Baker away with a massive knife. That's a hero moment. So I think it would be fun to do.
No, she didn't. That guy, the old man came and stepped in front of the knife.
Oh, okay, fine. Well, old man, Patient Zero, have a hero award then, you know? So
heroic moment, yeah.
Okay. Wow. I'll tell you what we're doing next. I can't believe you looked up how many probes there are. I can't believe that. And we will go back to Liz Shaw at some point, but we're not going to next week. So we're staying in 1994. And this is another company doing a straight-to-video. And it's called Shakedown, Return of the Sontarans.
Right, okay. Shakedown.
And everybody, it is out on... I mean, it came out on video in 1994. It's never been re-released, but... it has been put up online on a site. I can't remember what it's called. It's called MePipe or...
Link it in the comments.
MePipe or what is it? Me or You Pipe or Tube? YouTube? MePipe? Something like that. A couple of times uploaded. So listeners can watch along with us when we're doing it. Actually, I'm going to tell you as well. I'll tell you this. So obviously it's the Sontarans that are the licensed element this time around. But the Doctor Who actors that will feature, I think I should tell you so you know to look out for them, I think.
Okay.
Because it's always a mix of half and half. So this has Sophie Eldred, Ace.
Yeah.
And it's got Carol Ann Ford, Susan.
All right.
And it's got Terry Molloy, who played the first Davros, but you won't recognise him. So so you're looking out for Ace and Susan in this one.
Okay.
And the Sontarans.
Of course.
And it's about 50 minutes. They're not all this long. We're getting the longer ones out of the way. They do get shorter.
Okay.
You don't...
well, see. I mean, I did this and it was 50 minutes.
Exactly.
Back to the point, I said it because I only got the first 30 minutes originally. I had to get you to send it me again. I was like, I was enjoying that. I was doing it in one do.
Yeah, this is going to be amazing.
Hey, guys out there, 90s, miracles can happen. We're only on the second one, though. We're about to do the third.
Yes. So anyway, in the meantime, everyone, get looking for Shakedown. And you can follow us on Twitter and Instagram at TwoWatchWho. And you can support us at buymeacoffee.com/TwoWatchWho. Thank you so much to people who have bought us coffees recently. And we will see you very soon. Oh, and I should bring back our proper intros and outros, but I just... couldn't think of one this time. We could have been sitting in John Pertwee's couch, I suppose. But
okay, yeah. Well, we'll do that. We'll finish on this couch. Yeah.
I feel like we need
a record on.
Yeah. Okay. We'll do that. See you next time, everyone. Bye.
Watch who?